Hello, welcome again to the lecture course on relativity and cosmology. So last time I have discussed further the Robertson-Walker line element, which we arrived at by using observations and the cosmological principle. I also discussed the cosmological redshift and Hubble's law, at least heuristically. Today we discuss the dynamics. So what we do is we take the Robertson-Walker line element, put it into Einstein equations, and discuss the ensuing equations. So to recall, we have the following line element, ds squared is minus dt squared plus a squared of t dr squared over 1 minus k r squared plus r squared d theta squared plus r squared sine squared theta d phi squared. Yeah, with the three values for k, 0, plus 1, and minus 1. Now, in one of the exercises, you have used Cartan's formalism to derive the connections and the curvature and to put this into Einstein equations. So I don't have to do it here. I mean, just to recall, I mean, we write this with an orthonormal frame as minus theta naught, theta naught plus theta one plus theta two plus theta three, so that, I mean, using an orthonormal frame, so we can write this as an eta mu nu theta mu theta nu. If we define, okay, small w as a square root of 1 minus k r squared. I mean, that's the expression that comes from here. Now, if you have here the square root, then we can write this as, or you can see from this directly that theta 0 is dt, yeah, that theta 1 is a over w dr. No, that's just what you get from here. And then theta 2 is ar d theta, and theta 3 is ar times sine theta times d phi, right? So these are the four one forms, the co-frame. Now Cartan's equation means that we have d theta mu plus omega mu nu, which theta nu is equal to 0, the absence of torsion, and these are the connection components to be determined from this equation. So you take these thetas, you calculate here the exterior derivative, and then you can read off the omegas from here. And once you have read off, you know, because the result is unique, that you have found the correct result. So this is to be determined. And so this is Cartan 1, and the Cartan 2, we have omega mu nu is the curvature, two forms, d omega mu mu plus omega mu rho, which omega rho nu, and this we can expand, in, because it's a two form, we can expand it into the theta which thetas, and the coefficients are the curvatures, mu nu rho sigma theta rho which theta sigma, and so this is also to be determined like this. Now, so you first determine this, then you calculate this, and from that equation you read off the curvatures. No? And once you have the Riemann tensor components, then you derive from this the r mu nu and the r. And then the Einstein equations, so Einstein equations with T mu nu on the right hand side having the form of an ideal fluid, so just characterized by density and rho. I write it down again for you. Then you get what we call the Friedmann-Lemaître equations for A of T. Now, that's the only dynamical part here, the so-called scale factor, Well, everything else is fixed in terms of geometry, is rigid, but here this expresses the dynamics. I mean, space is homogeneous, isotropic, there is no point to change that, but the dynamics is, of course, free, and it is to be determined from the Einstein equations. No? So that's what follows here, and so you have done this in the exercises. Or you can read it in the books. It's a straightforward calculation of two or three pages, and there's no point to repeat it here. So if you then have the Einstein equations, R mu nu minus 1/2 g mu nu r, and I add here, of course, now importantly the cosmological constant is 8 pi g times g mu nu, and as I said, we put here the form of an ideal fluid entirely characterized by the density of energy or mass of matter or radiation and the pressure. So actually one can show that, I mean, if you have here this metric, that you have to make such an ansatz. So you cannot make, of course, an ansatz for an inhomogeneous energy momentum tensor if you have homogeneity in the metric. Yeah, so that's the ideal fluid. And so what you then get by this procedure here are then the Friedmann-Lemaître equations. So there are two of them. There's an equation for the second derivative, time derivative, and there's an equation for the first derivative squared. And so this turns out to be minus 4 pi g over 3 rho plus 3p times a plus lambda times a over 3. So let me call this the equation 1. And equation 2 is a dot squared is 8 pi g over 3 rho a squared plus lambda a squared over 3 minus k. Now here we have the direct explicit appearance of k here in this equation. You can also write this identically as follows by having, I mean, 8 pi g 3 a squared outside parenthesis minus k. Now, and you see here this factor lambda over 8 pi g occurs at the same position as the matter density. So this is also a density, but it comes only from the cosmological constant, and the cosmological constant in this sense, I mean, if it's there, even if there's no matter, it contributes, so we can call this the energy density of the vacuum, or the energy density, of course, related with gamma, so we call this rho vacuum, and also using the notation rho lambda. You find both of this in the literature. This is why I give here both definitions. And okay, in more modern texts, people seem to prefer rho lambda. So we call this the energy density of the vacuum. So these are then the Friedmann-Lemaître equations here. Do not write this down again. So this is here. These are these equations. And you see they are of a different nature. Of course, Einstein field equations are of second order. But only one of the two equations is of second order. The other is of first order. It means that's more a constraint on initial values, right? Because it means that if you solve this equation, you cannot fix a and a dot at a certain time independently. That's a general feature of the Einstein equation, has to do with the symmetries or redundancies of that equations. But you see here, very importantly, in addition to this here, this is the equation 2, we have this constraint equation, a dot squared. Out of these two equations, you can also derive a third one that is very important. So, I mean, if we here take this and multiply with a, then we have here a dot squared times a is 8 pi g over 3. Then you have rho a cube, then plus lambda a cube over 3 minus k times a. Now we solve this here with respect to rho times a cube. We perform the time derivative, so we get also, I mean, second time derivatives, and then we use this equation 1 to eliminate the second time derivative. No? So from this, using 1 also, we get then, I mean, just two or three steps, we get then an equation for rho a cube dot. So the motivation is that this, in a sense, density times scale factor cube resembles, say, the total energy density. It's not, I mean, it's not the same because a cube is not the volume, but just for formal reasons, there's this analogy. And if you use that equation, it brings the pressure into play, and you get here that PA3 dot is zero. So this gets also a name, so that's equation 3. And yeah, you see it has it resembles the form of a continuity equation, of course, with some modification by the pressure. And you also get this from team u nu semicolon u equals zero. Now, so it's consistent. I mean, we have derived it from here, but you can also use the energy momentum tensor and use the Couvreur conservation, and then you get this equation. Last time we have introduced the Hubble parameter. Now h, recall, is a dot over a with dimension of inverse time. Now you can also use h here to rewrite this equation 3. And so I just give you the result. So it is, so 3 can be written as rho dot plus 3h rho plus p equal to 0. So you have here an equation for the change of the energy density. Now this here, this combination, I think we had this before, it's called the inertial mass density. Yeah, so replacing the pure rho in Newtonian physics. I mean, a further motivation is if you look into generally in the general formalism, the momentum conservation equation. So if you have from T mu nu equal to zero, you get something like rho plus P u mu dot. Yeah, so an equation that has here the first derivative of the four velocity, and in front of this you have rho plus P. So this resembles the M times A in Newtonian physics, I mean the generalization of this. This is why we call this the inertial mass density. And if rho plus P is non-negative, say it's strictly positive, then we call this the weak energy condition. It's a restriction on the allowed form of matter. Yeah, the weak energy condition, to be precise, also demands that rho is positive. So we will not violate this positivity of the local energy density of matter. So this means if the weak energy condition is satisfied, and for the time being we can assume certainly for the types of matter we have that it is, then you see if the universe is expanding, so h is positive, then it means that rho dot is negative, so the energy density decreases when the universe expands, which corresponds only to our intuition. If the universe expands, the density should decrease. But you see, if you have some exotic form of matter where this is violated, and some people discuss this, it's a hypothetical form of matter, you would have, with the expansion of the universe, an increase in the density. Now, if we also accommodate the rho lambda or the rho v into this, then you see for rho v, which is constant, it's called cosmological constant, so for rho v equals constant, we have here, of course, rho v dot is zero because it's constant, but then you look into this equation here, and this means that rho is minus p. Rho v is minus pv. That is, you can accommodate, I mean, the cosmological constant into the matter sector, if you like. I mean, just writing this on the right-hand side and having just one t mu nu, that also includes that contribution. But then you must take into account that the vacuum energy has this unusual equation of state that rho is minus p. Because rho is taken to be positive, it can also be negative for negative cosmological constant, but if it's positive, it would mean then that the pressure is negative. So that's the equation of state for the vacuum. Yeah, I mentioned the last semester that already Schrödinger in 1918 had suggested to treat lambda in this way, not as something geometric on the left-hand side, but as an effective contribution to T mu nu on the right-hand side with this equation of state. And this is also the modern point of view. So in modern texts, mostly we do not, or one does not write the lambda explicitly here again and distinguishes between the lambda and the rho. Usually we write just the rho and p and assume that the lambda is accommodated by this equation of state. So later I will also proceed that, but for both for pedagogical and historic reasons, I will of course also write down versions with the lambda explicitly, because there you can see more explicitly what the cosmological constant entails. Okay, so we have these Friedmann-Lemaître equations, and of course we need an equation of state P as a function of rho and T, because otherwise, I mean, this is not fully determined here. I mean, we have to somehow give a relation between rho and P. So that's the equation of state. And so then you get the dynamics of the cosmological model. Now for today's universe, we have the fact that the pressure of the ordinary matter, I mean in terms of the density, and to make it dimensionless, rho c squared is smaller than around 10 to the minus 4, so for ordinary matter, the stars and gas clouds and the like, and so we take p approximately 0, or we take actually p equal to 0, and we call that dust, because dust does not have pressure on, dust particles do not exert pressure on each other. So when we talk about dust or about the matter-dominated universe, then what we mean is that we can take pressure to zero. I mean, of course, there's always some pressure somewhere, but it means that for the dynamics of, say, the galaxies, which we take as points in cosmology, I mean, the pressure is negligible. Now, for p equals zero, if you go to this equation, then you see here that rho a cube dot is zero, which means for p equals zero means, I mean, from equation three, that rho a cube is constant. So we can give this a name. We call it 3m over 4 pi, because this has the dimension of an energy or mass, And the factors are just chosen such that you have an analogy with Newtonian physics, where you have mass conservation, and where this would just refer to the total, well, I mean, 4 pi 3 times this to the total mass within a sphere. No, so this is from analogy with Newtonian physics, mass conservation. And so if you have that, I mean, equation 2, then gives here the following. I mean, I multiply by 1/2 so that you have a form of a Newtonian energy law. So from 2, you get then 1/2 a dot square. Then I replace rho a cubed by that, so which this is rho a cubed over a. So we have here minus gm over a, and then the lambda term is a minus k over 2. So this we put to the other side and define this to be an energy over a mass. No? So we have cast this equation into a pseudo-Newtonian form, which is only possible if you have pressure zero. And you see here old friends appearing, I mean, the Newtonian potential, gm over a. And then we have also something new that is connected with the cosmological constant that Newton did not have. But you see also you have here an old friend, the harmonic oscillator potential a squared. And that's the constant energy. No? So that would be the energy law, at least at a formal level, the energy law in Newtonian cosmology. Yeah, okay, this is not quite correct in Newtonian cosmology. Of course, one has lambda equals zero, but say in a pseudo-Newtonian cosmology for a co-moving volume. But we do not have only equation of state for dust. I mean, you have seen that we have this cosmic microwave background, which is electromagnetic radiation filling our universe. So we also have radiation in the universe, and radiation has a different equation of state. So radiation, as you know from thermodynamics, has the equation of state that P is rho over 3, well, rho c squared over 3. And if you have this, and we insert this into this law here, then of course you get rho as a function of a. So from equation 3, you get that rho actually then a to the fourth. I mean, it's a simple differential equation that you have to solve, and you get an additional power here in this, no, compared to here. Now here we have here a cube, and here we have a to the four, and the difference comes from this versus that. Now, since rho plus 3p enters here, which by the way is called the active gravitational mass density because it's on the right hand side of the modified Poisson equation. So if we have here dust, then you just have rho. If we have a radiation, we have p is rho over 3, so we have 2 rho. So you see that the density contributes twice as much. I mean, for the radiation density contributes twice as much to a double dot compared to dust. So, I don't have to write this down. Now, we can have an even more general equation of state. So if we have here a linear relation that we write p is some constant times rho. I mean, this accommodates both this here, but also this here for the cosmological constant, because then w is just minus 1. So we call this it is called the barotropic equation of state in thermodynamics. The barotropic means that the rho only depends on the P and not on something like temperature, which of course you could also have. The baros, Greek, means pressure, and tropos, Greek, means direction or rotation. So for example, water is approximately barotropic. Okay, anyway, whatever how call it, if you have this here, then you can directly insert this into this equation and solve for rho of A. So that's a nice and simple exercise that I encourage you to do. It's just a very few step, and then you get, I mean, from equation 3, that rho times A, and as the power 3 times 1 plus W is constant. So maybe this deserves an extra color red. So here, this law includes all the special cases. Of course, there are also possibilities for other equations of state, nonlinear relations, and for example, in cosmology, we discuss also something where P is inversely proportional to rho. For our purpose, this will not play a role. Now, we will come back to that in the winter term for the early universe, but here, I mean, we are fully happy with this class of equation of state, which gives here to Daniel. You see here, thus this W equals zero, you get here back that. Radiation, you have W equal to 1/3, gives back that. And vacuum has W equal minus 1, and you get rho equals constant. So let me return to this second Friedmann-Lemaître equation, the constraint equation for A dot squared. Let me rewrite it in different form. We want to have it in a form where all the terms are dimensionless. That's nice for particular purposes, for example, purposes related to direct observations. So divide the equation 2 by A squared. And when you do that, you see you have here A dot squared over A squared, which is the Hubble parameter squared. Then here this A squared disappears. And here we have minus K over A squared. So what you get is then that on the left-hand side, we have the Hubble parameter squared. And the right-hand side, 8PG over 3 rho plus rho vacuum minus k over a squared. Now, let me define a crucial quantity, and this is called the critical density, rho c. You will understand in a minute why it's called the critical density. And formally it's motivated by here, by this equation, because then we can when we divide by h squared, then you have here the inverse on the right-hand side of this critical density. So we can write 1 is then rho plus rho v over the critical density minus k over a squared h squared. Okay, this is already an equation with dimensionless terms. So let me give those separate names, and they are the so-called omega parameters. Omega is defined as the density over the critical density. I mean, this is what appears here. And so we can also do this for the vacuum, rho v over rho c, although you could, as I said, accommodate the rho v into rho. But let me write it separately. And the rest gets then also a name, omega k is minus k over a squared h squared. No? So that's, in a sense, it's the remaining term, and it's the omega parameter connected with curvature. No? And of course, we can also call this omega lambda, and people in the literature also call this omega lambda. So that you can, you see with this, you can, I mean, writing first this on the left-hand side, you can have then omega plus omega vacuum plus omega k is equal to 1. So that's a simply looking equation. That I think all of you can remember, which means that the sum of all the omegas is 1. Of course, you have to recall what omega k is, but the other contributions you get by having the corresponding energy density over the critical energy density. In cosmology, as I said also last time, I mean, if we evaluate quantities today, I mean, for the present universe, we add subscript 0 to that. So if I've evaluated today, then we write, I mean, omega 0 plus omega v 0 plus omega k 0 is equal to 1. And also the critical density today is then 3 times the Hubble constant squared over 8 pi g. Now, so whenever there is a 0, or we call it sometimes also omega naught or omega 0, then it's evaluated today. Often 1, I mean, omega is the total rho. For the today's universe, of course, we have the radiation and we have the dust and perhaps some unknown components, but these two we definitely have. The vacuum is here separately, so often we write also omega as omega matter plus omega radiation. No? So that's the matter, which means P equals 0, and that's radiation, which means P is rho over 3. Now, this is from the CMB, and this is, I mean, what you see, and also matter that you cannot see, but that contributes. Now, why critical density? Of course, it comes first from a dimensional analysis, but there is more to that, because you can write this equation, and, okay, this also gets a number 4. I mean, you can write 4 in the suggestive form, that on the left-hand side we have omega plus omega v, and the right you have 1 plus k over a squared h squared. Now the omega k minus omega k is plus k over h squared a squared. Now, this here, I mean, you have the 3 cases, k is 0, plus 1, and minus 1. So this can be 0. I mean, for k equals 0, it can be positive for k plus 1, and it can be negative for k minus 1. No? So you see that, I mean, for that k equal to 0, then this is just 1, and this means that rho plus rho vacuum is equal to the critical density. No? And if k is plus 1, you have rho plus rho v is bigger than the critical, because then this is bigger than 1, the right-hand side, so then this is here bigger than rho c. And for k equals minus 1, rho plus rho v is smaller than rho c. No? So you see, and this is an important fact that cannot be overemphasized, that the total energy density, rho plus rho v, fixes the geometry of the universe in these Friedmann models, right? Because here, I mean, remember this was the flat case, the positively curved, the negatively curved, so in the simplest, the sphere or the pseudosphere. It does not fix, of course, the global topology, whether you have the sphere or maybe something more complicated where you identify points, but it fixes the geometry. Mm-hmm. So this means that the total energy density rho plus rho v fixes the geometry of the universe. So instead of measuring the geometry directly by counting galaxies or via the CMB, you can just try to look at today's universe, I mean, what is the rho plus rho v? And you have to measure the Hubble constant, and then you can compare the two. In principle, this can be nicely done. The problem is that, I will mention this later, but I say it already now, that from the observations rho plus rho v is within the error bars equal to rho c. So because of the error bars, of course, you cannot definitely conclude that it's zero. Yeah, it can be a little bit in this regime or a little bit that regime. For today also, we have from observations that the radiation today, the omega parameter is much smaller than omega matter zero. Of course, the CMB is relevant for cosmology, we observe it, but in terms of the energy density, it contributes much less. So about a factor of 10 to the minus 4 or so than that. No? So mostly we can, at least for the energy budget, we can neglect this. No? So that we can write here that omega 0 here is approximately omega m0. No? And so what we want, what the observational cosmologists want then to determine is then, I mean, the following parameters. So typically a two-dimensional diagram where you have here omega v0 and here omega m0. So just the matter and the cosmological constant, because that is neglected, it would correspond to a third direction, but it's irrelevant. Okay, this is omega lambda 0, and then to determine the point what our universe corresponds to. No? So that's no, from observations. So I will summarize this later, what we have, but of course I can already tell you now that observations tell that today this is about 2/3 and this is about 1/3, this number. With error bars, so 2/3 the lambda, omega lambda, and 1/3 the omega. Of course, this is very detailed analysis that you have to do. And then you see here that this gives around 1. And so you see you can only give some limits on this. No? It's 1 plus minus, so we don't know really what k is. So we have written down the Friedmann-Lemaître equations. We can also use another parameter in that, which has, which is used by us astronomers and also historically. It's called the deceleration parameter. Its name, it's small q, and it's defined by the acceleration, a double dot, but made dimensionless. So that's only a number. You can make it dimensionless by multiplying with a over a dot squared. So that's a dimensionless version of a double dot. So we have here q positive for a double dot negative. That's how was it defined. So so this is dimensionless. It was defined this way because people thought very long in the history of modern cosmology that a double dot is negative, that the universe expands but is decelerating and becomes slower. This is why it was defined here with a minus, and this is why it was called a deceleration parameter. Now, as I will tell you later, the present universe is accelerating, so a double dot is positive. And so for a bit strange reasons, now we still use the deceleration parameter, although the universe is accelerating. Now, from the Friedmann equation, Friedmann-Lemaître equation number one, which is the A double dot equation number one, you can rewrite it in the following form. So what we want is to replace a double dot by q. So that's a simple exercise. You get this, rho plus 3p, and then you can convince yourself that here instead of the a double dot, we have this term minus q times a squared. Now, so for example, if you had a universe with lambda equals zero and with dust, then you would directly have, so this would not be here, you would directly get here that q is omega over 2. If you remember the omega, which is here with a factor of 8. Now, this can be used to eliminate lambda from equation 2. So use this to eliminate lambda from equation 2, the one where I only have a dot squared. And if you do that, you get k over a squared is 8 pi g over 3 rho plus 4 pi g over 3 rho plus 3p minus q squared. Now that's here the lambda term, lambda over 3, no? So that's what we have here written, minus h squared. So if you again make use of the omega, so rho is omega times critical density, which is omega times 3h squared over 8 pi g, then what you get is h squared over 2 times 3 omega plus p over rho c minus 2q minus 2. Now, so if we evaluate this today, so do that here. So evaluate it today, where we have p equals to 0. For the matter part, then we have here k over a naught squared is Hubble constant squared over 2. And we have 3, got 0 minus 2, q 0 minus 2. So you can rewrite, I mean, always the same equation into this form. Well, you have the two equations, and you can, of course, manipulate them, where you have now the q naught here, the present deceleration parameter, the present density parameter, omega, I mean, rho over rho critical. So why is it done in that way? Because here, these are the things that are, in principle, observable. So here, so this here, this determines the sign of k, because they are in principle observable. Now, a Friedmann-Lemaître model is fixed by the four parameters that you have to determine from observer. Of course, you have to measure the Hubble constant, which gives the present expansion rate. You have to measure, I mean, the omega naught, which is, of course, consists of radiation and matter separately, and the vacuum here, which we have explicitly eliminated, but okay, you can instead also measure the Q zero. So that is usually negligible, but I mean principle there. So these are the four parameters that fix the Friedmann-Lemaître model. As you can also see from this equation, I mean here did the two here, not the first and the second derivative, so deceleration parameter and expansion rate, and then we have the omega that is written here in these two terms. So four parameters need to be determined, and I will give you later, of course, after we have learned a little bit more about the solutions, which solution fits best the observations. Now, let us have a fresh look at the Hubble parameter. So the Hubble parameter H, it has as you see from this definition, it's a dot over a, so it has dimension. So it has dimension time to the minus one, inverse time. So you could just give it in 1/2 seconds, say, and sometimes it's done. But in astronomy, one uses different units that are tailored to observations. So recall that, I mean, the Hubble's law, we can write in this pseudo Doppler shift version that velocity is c times z is distance time h naught. And so distances we measure in astronomy in cosmology in megaparsec typically. And okay, the velocities are of orders of kilometers per second. And so if you use that, then we get that, I mean, the Hubble parameter can be written as kilometers per second and megaparsec. That's what the astronomers do. So we can, so dimension, so in astronomy, dimension of h naught is taken to be kilometers per second and megaparsec. Of course, you could also write it by expressing megaparsecs in terms of kilometers. Of course, you can write it also in inverse seconds, but that would be given a very small number, which you can avoid by using this, because if we use the parameter small h, so we divide h naught by 100 kilometers per second and megaparsec, then from observations we have that this is of order 1, and this is what is convenient here. So this is also called then the dimensionless Hubble constant. Of course, if you have this as an inverse time, then of course there's a certain time associated with that, and this is called the Hubble time, th, which is just h naught to the minus 1. And by this, we can write this now really in years. It's around 9.78, the small h to the minus 1 giga years. No? Giga years are 10 to the minus 9 years. No? So you see, if this h is of order 1, then of course the age of the universe is of the order 10 to the 10 years, and the precise number has to be determined by observation. So from observations, I mean, there's of course this discrepancy from different observations, but from the cosmological observations, if we take small h around 2/3, then you get a th, it's around 14.6 giga years, the Hubble time. Of course, the age of the universe is something different. It's not just h to the minus 1. It has to be determined from the exact curve, h of t. But this coincides astonishingly well with the age of the universe that we determine later, which is about 13.8 giga years. The critical density today is a rho c naught, this 3 h naught squared over 8 pi g, and if you insert numbers, this is around 1.88 times 10 to the minus 29 h squared, if you express it in gram per cubic centimeter. As you see, this is the average cosmic density of matter and radiation, and this is of course very small, of the order of 10 to the minus 29, if you measure in everyday units gram per cubic centimeter. But this is an average which reflects the fact that of course between the stars and the galaxies there's a lot of just empty space. So today we have also pressure is approximately zero of matter, but did this always hold? Did this always hold? Well, the answer is no, because I mean the CMB is the leads to this radiation density parameter, which you can also call omega CMB. There's also contribution by neutrinos, which I neglect here. So from observation, so neglecting neutrinos here, they would give order of the same in addition. So and the observations from the Planck and also from already from the COBE satellite give, I mean, 2.5 times 10 to the minus 5 h to the minus 2. So if we insert h around 0.67, then we have around 5.6 times 10 to the minus 5, which is much smaller than 1. So today, I mean, really, I mean, this is negligible. But you recall what we did half an hour or so again. I mean, for radiation, we don't have rho a cube is constant, but rho a to the fourth is constant. Yeah. So we have here, but rho r a to the fourth is constant. So which means that if you look back in time, and from today to smaller values of a, it means that rho radiation increases compared to rho matter. No, I mean, if you look forward in time, radiation decreases faster. This is why it's so small today. But if you go back in time, it's just the opposite, which means that has dominated in the past. Has dominated in the past. And this is what gave rise to the picture of the hot Big Bang, as it was coined in the 1950s, that, I mean, before some critical time, the universe was radiation dominated, and so it was, the temperature was very high, and this is what leads to the picture of the hot Big Bang. Okay, but not discussing this hot Big Bang further right now, let me conclude this section with a remark, what can be said generally about the past, independent now of this detail. So if we have again a fresh look at equation one, so we have a double dot is a minus 4 pi g over 3 a rho plus 3 p minus lambda over 4 pi g. And this is here 2 rho vacuum. Now, so I mean here, just to remind you, minus 2 rho vacuum is the same as rho v plus 3 pv, because pv is minus rho v. So it fits into this general form of the equation. So, but what I want to emphasize is the following. So if this term here, the parenthesis, is non-negative, then it would mean that a double dot is smaller or equal than zero. No? So if rho plus 3p minus lambda over 4 pi g is bigger or equal to zero, then it would mean that a double dot is smaller than zero. No? So if this condition holds, and this means that a of t, whatever it looks like in detail, it has this concave graph because of this. This means that if these conditions are fulfilled, or at least they are fulfilled before some time, that can also could be a time in the past, then a is zero at a finite time in the past. No? You see, this goes to zero at some time. It does not, like in a convex graph, say it goes here up. So then a of t is zero at a finite time in the past. And the a equal to zero, this is what we call a singularity, because if you look, for example, at a Riemann curvature or the Ricci scalar, it diverges. So this here corresponds then to a singularity in space-time. Well, we had met singularities in the case of black holes. So this is another example of singularities, which means that here, I mean, rho goes to zero because rho goes to, has 1 over 8 to the 3 or 1 a to the 4th for a to 0. And also curvature invariance. Curvature invariance go to infinity for a to 0. Now, if we make the observations today, then we find actually, because we have we observe a positive cosmological constant. So today we have rho plus 3p, okay, minus 2 rho v is negative. So today we have a convex graph. That is, if this were true all the time, of course we could avoid actually singularities. But from cosmological observation, because the universe becomes, if you go back in past, and becomes matter-dominated and then radiation-dominated, so this condition will be fulfilled in the past. So, for times t smaller than t tilde, which we have to determine from observations, a concave graph is valid from observation, and thus we expect, of course, I mean, we never know what happens, I mean, very, very early, it depends then also on speculative physics, but if this were true, I mean, all the time, then thus we would expect a singularity, and thus we expect a singularity in spite of rho plus 3p minus 2 rho v negative today. I should mention, and we had this earlier in section 10.7, there are these so-called singularity theorems that can be applied to black holes. And I mentioned them in that context, but also to cosmology. And the singularity theorems make a general statement that if this holds generally, and in the general case it's called strong energy condition, that then, I mean, plus some other conditions, a singularity is unavoidable. No? So, singularity theorems. Well, briefly mentioned there. So for strong energy condition, which is chi mu nu xi mu is bigger than the trace over 2 for all time like xi mu, and this corresponds for the Friedmann model to rho plus vp bigger or equal than 0, plus other conditions that seem to be fulfilled, then we have a singularity. These days, people discuss about an inflationary phase in the very early universe, I mean, very close to t equals 0, which also violates this here. So the question is arises again, whether there's a singularity. It seems that this is not, that one cannot avoid a singularity by this. It depends on the exact numbers and so on. But it's still somewhat uncertain, and it could be, of course, that a singularity is avoided by taking into account this very early phase. Anyway, at very, very early times, we expect the quantum theory of gravity to be relevant. And anyway, we expect there are very different formulation and that singularities are avoided in the quantum theory. But this, of course, goes far beyond the frame or the scope of this lecture. Okay, so that's all for today. So next time in 12.6, we do something that is very relevant for observations. So we discuss various distance measures, because I can easily write down a d and call it a distance, but you cannot take a ruler and just check the distance. I mean, you have to, for example, observe luminosities from stars and so on. So I will define in particular a luminosity distance, and then we have to derive exactly, I mean, a Hubble's law using that, not just heuristically as we did before, but derive it really exactly. Thanks for today, and until next time.